everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
We are observing Epiphany Sunday, this Sunday, even though it's not technically Epiphany yet. We're still in the middle of Christmas time. So I have some sad news for our congregation this morning. Lola Mae Barraker passed away yesterday. Ruthie was with her, and arrangements are being made. I believe that the service will be held here on Friday, but that's all the information I have, and even that is not firmed up yet. So I will keep you posted with the details as they are available. We want to keep Lola Mae's family and our church family in our prayers. So a couple of announcements as we begin our time together. This one is not in your bulletin. It came in too late, and for some reason this date was not on my calendar, so I had to get it from our church council chair. So thank you, Carrie, for helping me out there. January 31st is our next church council meeting. That's at 7 p.m. That's a Monday. So January 31st is our church council meeting. On January 14th, that's the deadline for the 2022 REACH sponsorship matching program that REACH Across America is doing. You can see the announcement in the duly noted section for more details on that, including the link you can use so that Temple gets the credit for your donation. January 25th, it's a Tuesday, and that's when our Bible study will resume at 7 p.m. Right, well, not in here, but down in the kitchen, January 25th. On January 30th, we'll have our annual Valentine contest here at Temple, and that will start at 9:15 a.m., so you want to be working on your Valentine's. Even now, I know February is the month for Valentine's Day, but we have to get those ready, and some of you people are very creative with your Valentine's, so it probably takes you a whole month, or maybe it's just me. To do something that good, it would take me a month. But anyway, work on those Valentine's, and on January 30th, we'll see them all here at 9:15. And March 5th is the date for Tools for Ministry this year. That's all I know, is the date. I don't know where it's going to be, how it's going to be, whether it's virtual or not, or anything else. So that is the date. And who knows, maybe that won't even change. No. One never knows in these days of pandemic. I think that's all the announcements that I have. Does anybody have additional information? Linda?
I'm looking for news for the newsletter.
Okay.
So I need it by Tuesday or Wednesday. If you have any, please email me.
Okay. So yeah, I guess we're going to be, the plan is to have that available next week. So, yeah, you want to get, if you have items for the newsletter, get them to Linda ASAP. Any other announcements? All right, then, let's continue in our worship with a moment for reflection. Stand with me as we join in our call to worship together. You'll find the call to worship printed in your book. Arise, shine, for your light has come.
Let the lamp shine in your dark place.
Like sages from afar, come and behold your Christ.
Let us be attentive to his presence and his message as we seek to walk in his light.
Their opening hymn this morning is We Three Kings. That's number 254 in your hymnals. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 5. And if you're joining us online, you should have those words printed in your bulletin.
Thank you.
to join me also in our opening prayer, which you will find printed in your bulletin. Let's pray together.
Everlasting God, the radiance of faithful souls, you brought the nations to your light and kings to the brightness of your rising. Fill the world with your glory and show yourself to all nations through him who is the true light and the bright and morning star, even Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Amen. And you may be seated.
Our first scripture today is from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go, search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. This is the word of the Lord.
Say hi. Say hi, everybody.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Mary, did you know that your baby?
And continuing with the reading of God's Word, today we turn now to the Gospel for this morning, which comes from the Gospel according to John. From chapter 1, we're going to hear 1 through 5, 9 through 14, and 16 and 17. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. From his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. The law, indeed, was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. The movie Ronin, directed by the late John Frankenheimer, contains the best car chase scene ever filmed. Better than the one in Bullet, starring Steve McQueen, very famous car chase scene. Better even than the classic car chase in The French Connection. Now this, it is a fact. You can't argue with it. But this fact has nothing to do with today's message, but I thought you should know in case you haven't seen the film before. Now, that little bit of misdirection that I just did, saying something that appears to be connected to the topic at hand but really isn't connected at all, that is what this message is about. Now, the movie Ronin itself is a study in misdirection. And if you haven't seen it, you really should. It appears to be about a group of professional thieves who plan to take possession of a briefcase. The case contains some unknown but important item, and indeed, you really never find out what's in the case. It's the classic film MacGuffin. We don't know. We never know what's in the case, but it contains something important. So one of these agents, or these professional thieves, named Sam, claims to be a former CIA operative. And one of the other guys in this band says to Sam, "Well, what happened?" And Sam says, "I left." However, some of these thieves are not what they appear to be. Several of them have hidden agendas that only become clear as the plot unfolds. And this includes the main character, Sam, played by Robert De Niro in the movie, who, during the film's final moments, reveals his real purpose to the same partner in crime. He says simply, "I never left." Which, of course, causes you to rethink much of what you already saw or thought you saw. So the film reminds me of Epiphany, which is today. In truth, it only appears to be today. The actual festival of Epiphany falls on January 6th, which is Thursday. The Feast of Epiphany is celebrated at the beginning of each year on the day after the 12th day of Christmas. Now, Epiphany commemorates the visit of the Magi to the manger of the infant Jesus. The episode is recounted in one of our most beloved hymns that we sang this morning, We Three Kings. But there is a lot about Epiphany that, like Sam in the movie Ronin, isn't what it appears to be. Almost everything about the event that inspired the Feast of the Epiphany, as it's described in Matthew's Gospel, is not what it appears to be. There are, in other words, a lot of misappearances in the Epiphany story. Now, misappearances is not a word. But it should be. And at least for the next few minutes, I'd like to pretend that it is. Misappearances will, for now, appear to be a word. Let's look at the misappearances of Epiphany. The three kings are not who they appear to be. In fact, only one word of the title of our hymn, We Three Kings, is correct. We. Ancient sources agree that there was more than one visitor from the east, but we have no idea how many there were, other than two or more. There may have been three of them. There was probably an entire caravan of servants and other assistants that traveled with these visitors. Who knows? Maybe not, but maybe. Maybe there were a total of three dignitaries in the party, but then again, maybe there was only two, or maybe it was 10. Matthew says they brought three gifts, but he never says how many kings, or how many magi there were. Sorry, speaking of kings. Now, where were we? Yes. We three kings. I'm not sure where the idea that these guys were royalty came from, but it didn't come from the scriptures. The scripture for Matthew refers to the visitors as magi, which does not mean king. Magi is commonly translated as magician, but it actually refers to stargazers. These guys were probably what today we would refer to as astrologers. Because of this, preacher and writer John Piper concludes that they were pagans and that they practiced dark arts. Perhaps they were even Satan worshippers. But that conclusion is just as full of conjecture as the idea that these guys were kings, or that there were three of them. The Magi were as close to astronomers as anybody would have been in those days. They were kind of like the scientists of the day. Maybe data analysts or something like that. They watched and studied the stars to see if they could learn anything about reality from them. It's possible that some or all of them believed in the God of Israel. At the very least, they must have had at least a passing familiarity with the Hebrew scriptures because they knew exactly where to go when the star appeared. And talk about accuracy, they were only off by 9 miles. And when they found Jesus, they worshipped him and gave him gifts. Gifts that they had planned in advance to give him. Their trip was a pilgrimage to see the one who would bring the redemption of Israel. That is hardly something that pagans, even the most learned ones, would do. The Magi probably misinterpreted what sort of king they were coming to see. But then again, so did pretty much the entire nation of Israel. The Magi were certainly more eager to honor this new king than Herod was. Speaking of Herod, who was at the time king of the Jews, he is also not what he appears to be. Herod would do anything to remain king indefinitely. And we know this because he murdered his sons and killed a great many rabbis during his reign in order to consolidate his power. He could not tolerate so much as the hint of a future threat to his title, King of the Jews. That is why when the visitors show up in his court asking where to find the child, he pretends to be something he is not, a prospective worshiper of this newborn king. Herod appears to be looking for the redemption of Israel, but he is not. Like the Magi, Herod misinterprets the presence of Jesus. But unlike the Magi, Herod went to his grave with those misconceptions about Jesus intact. Next on the list of misappearances is something that Matthew makes very clear in his gospel, but which Christians throughout history have deliberately depicted incorrectly. So Herod may have imagined, you know, the boy Jesus, who would be king, swaddled in golden blankets with handmaids attending him. Perhaps the visitors from the east expected him to be, at the very least, born into circumstances befitting royalty. But when they arrive, they find what was probably a nondescript house in a nondescript town, kind of out of the way. Nothing special. A home, like many others. The Christmas story that has been handed down to us over the years has been subjected to a great deal of, how can I say this kindly, development. Take a look at any nativity scene and you will conclude that Jesus was born in a stable, basically in the outdoors with animals standing around. Now, if you've ever been here on a Christmas Eve when we actually do things inside and there's like a Christmas sermon, you probably know what I'm about to say. As we all know, he was born in such a terrible location because the nasty innkeeper wouldn't let Mary and Joseph in, despite Mary's obvious state of advanced labor. There was no inn in the village of Bethlehem. The word inn in Luke's Christmas story can indeed mean a guest house, but it more commonly referred to a guest room in a house, or even more likely, the word that gets translated in simply meant place where they stayed. So there was not a lot of room in the place where they stayed. And that's why Jesus was laid in the manger, which is a Sunday school people from a few weeks ago. A manger is a
feed trough.
Plenty of which were kept indoors, along with animals from time to time. Animals might have been kept indoors too, and the feed trough was there with the animals. Anyway, Matthew clearly states that upon arriving, the Magi entered a house. It's right there in verse 11 of the reading that we heard this morning. A house. And since Jesus was probably about 18 months old at the time of their visit, the Magi likely didn't find him in that manger or wrapped in swaddling clothes. He might have been, you know, taking his first faltering steps. Christmas and everything attached to it, including Epiphany, appears to be something that it's not, because for whatever reasons, the church has concocted a sanitized, almost Disney-fied version. The reality is much different. What the visitors found when they arrived was an ordinary, almost toddler, in an ordinary house. One that was maybe like yours or mine. Unlike the visiting Magi, who most likely did look like VIPs and were probably treated as such in Herod's court in Jerusalem, Jesus did not appear to be important. Jesus looked like any other baby, and notwithstanding the hymn lyrics which say, "No crying he makes," he probably made some crying now and again, and he probably made other things too. Jesus was a baby, a human baby, just like all of us were at one time. And I'm sure he did what all babies do. Pardon the pun. To the people of Israel who were waiting for a Messiah, this must have been a tremendous letdown. Perhaps this is why we know next to nothing about Jesus' formative years. As Matthew says, the Magi's purpose in visiting caused quite a stir in Jerusalem. But with time, those disturbing expectations seemingly came to nothing. And Israel kind of lost track of Jesus. Epiphany is full of missed appearances. The visitors that we thought were kings were not. The actual king, Herod, appears to be interested in the fulfillment of the messianic hope of the Jewish people, but he is not. And the situation surrounding Jesus' birth, well, almost nothing about that story accurately reflects reality. Which brings to my mind the other scripture for this morning from John. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him. But the world did did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. He came into the world, Jesus came into the world that he had created. Yet the world didn't recognize him. They were expecting somebody else. And the one who appeared didn't appear to be the one they were hoping for. Instead, the world made up a different story, one that we like better because it's extraordinary and special. But the reality of Jesus' appearance in the world is much more ordinary. He came to ordinary people in an ordinary place who were, by and large, going about their ordinary lives. Jesus himself was, of course, extraordinary, but he didn't appear to be. And because of that, many of Jesus' own people stopped expecting his appearance, even today, in our messed up, pandemic-stricken, strife-riven reality. In Jesus, it might seem like our messianic hopes came to nothing. Maybe we, when hope appears to be lost, and when the potential for us to see and experience God at work in our world, in our neighborhood, in our church, in our lives, appears to have come to nothing, appears to be gone. When Jesus appears to have forgotten about us, and our cares, our griefs, and our joys appear to be too ordinary for him to care about, when the pandemic is entering its third calendar year, maybe it seems as if God has left us on our own. But maybe we think that because we have ceased to be alert for God's presence. Maybe we're no longer expecting to behold God in the ordinary circumstances of our lives. Maybe we're expecting God to show up on a cloud with angels surrounded by, trumpets and things like that. And maybe someday that's the way it will happen, but that's not the way it happens today. Maybe we're not expecting Jesus to show up, not in a second coming cataclysmic end of history kind of way, but in an everyday, Jesus actually does love us and cares about even the little things of our own lives sort of way. Maybe, and this is a radical thought, maybe Jesus doesn't need to show up. After all, how can you show up in a place where you already are? The true story of Epiphany tells us that it is at the very moment when God seems not to have appeared that we should be most ready for a sudden realization that God is closer than we thought and always was. Now is the moment to be ready for the realization that in Jesus, God says, "I never left." That's great. God, we celebrate your coming into the world as a human being at Christmas, and your appearance, your revelation to the world in Jesus, who would grow up to be our Christ and is our Savior today. We celebrate the appearing. And sometimes we can lose sight of the fact that you didn't have to show up. You came to the world in the form of Jesus, but you were already here. And even though Jesus is not with us in the flesh in this life now, he doesn't need to show up. Jesus, we acknowledge that you are among us now. As you even said, wherever two or more are gathered, I'm there. You're here. And when we look at the world around us, it can become easy to forget. So help us miss appearances of your absence aside,
recognize every day that you have shown up and are already here, but you never left.
God's word read and proclaimed today, and today I'd like to do something different. Instead of a prayer of confession, which we usually would have at this point in service, I've put in the Wesleyan Covenant prayer for us to say together. The Wesleyan Covenant prayer was written by John Wesley several centuries ago, and it is from time to time used in many Methodist congregations as a reaffirmation of our covenant. It is a prayer, but we take it almost as a creed, a statement of faith. And I think it's an extraordinary prayer that John Wesley composed, so I would like us to share it at this time. And you'll find it printed in your bulletin. Let's say this prayer together. I am no longer my own, but thine. Put me to what thou wilt. Grant me with whom thou wilt. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed by thee, or laid aside for thee. Exalted for thee, or brought low for thee. Let me be full of all. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to thy pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, thou art mine, and I am thine, so be it. And the covenant which I am made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen.
And at this time, I invite our usher or ushers to come forward so that we may share an offering our gift. Actually, we might do that. Before the ushers come forward, let me say a word about that response. I put it in special for this week. Actually, I put it in before I knew what had happened, but this response, goodness is stronger than evil, was written by Archbishop Desmond Tutu, who passed away this week. I put it in here before that happened, so, you know, the Lord's providence, and that's why I kind of wanted to sing it. So, you may not know it, and we're not going to have the music. I guess we'll go ahead with the response that you were going to adopt. And maybe
we can just read it?
I suppose we can just read it. We can just read it right now. And we'll try to get the music together for next week so that we can sing this together. Let's read that response together before our offer. Goodness is stronger than evil. Love is stronger than hate. Light is stronger than darkness. Life is stronger than death. Victory is ours. Victory is ours through him who loved us. Victory is ours. Victory is ours through him who loved us. Thank you. thank you for the multitude of voices that sing of your praises at Christmas time. We thank you for the revelation of your Son in this world that we celebrate at Epiphany. We thank you for, most of all, for the great gift of salvation, for the great gift of inclusion in your kingdom that you have offered to us and to all people. Help us to be faithful bearers of that invitation in this world. Take and use us and take and use the gifts that we have offered back to you this morning for that purpose. For we pray it in Jesus' name and all God's people said,
Amen.
You may be seated. It's actually kind of fun to hear like three verses of hymns being sung simultaneously. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and prayers.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth, or you had formed the earth from everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You created light out of darkness and brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light, and our salvation. You guided the wise to Jesus by the light of his star, and throughout the world you continue to lead people from far places to his light, where they receive good news and healing and grace upon grace. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus was delivered up for our sake, he shared a final meal with his friends, and during that meal he took bread and he broke it and he gave thanks for it and offered it to his friends, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, broken for you." When the supper was concluded, Jesus took the cup and again offered it to his friends, giving thanks for it, and said, "Take and drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins." And Jesus urged his friends that every time they should take the bread and the cup, that they should do so in remembrance of him. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ as we are for the world, the body of Christ. Redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
At this time, we're going to share any joys and concerns that we have so that we can come before the Lord in prayer over those. And I invite you to, if you have any joys or concerns on your hearts and minds, to share them with us at this time. Anyone want to start us off? Joy?
I have a joy. My niece, Rachel, got engaged over the holidays, and she's going to get married the next November.
Congratulations, Rachel. And we'll pray for her and her fiance, Sue.
I'll give you the Gordy update.
Yes.
After 27 days in the hospital and 16 days in rehab.
blessings of strength and
persistence
for sharing. That's great. Thank you for sharing that. Gary?
I'd like to thank God for a safe and healthy trip to and from Europe, a chance to be together with my daughter and son-in-law and my son and daughter-in-law, all six of us together over the holidays. So praise God for that. But then I also have a concern to share. My niece's husband, Ira, who's been battling cancer for years, is going to begin a bone marrow transplant this week. And that will be a lengthy process, about two and a half months. And he's going to have to live separate from the family in Baltimore while this process is going on. So it's going to be difficult for him, for his wife, his two elementary age kids, to have daddy away for such a serious reason for that length of time. And just pray that this bone marrow transplant finally works and gives Ira relief from all that's been going through.
We'll pray for him and for his family.
I started off as a concern, but Thursday, coming home from school, which Grant has an hour drive back and forth each way on the turnpike and all those fun roads, he lost his brakes.
Oh my gosh.
He managed to get the car off the road. No accidents, everything was fine. And the joy part of that is John, who fixed the car for us and had it back to us on New Year's Eve. So we are very thankful for the people who take care of our vehicles, and I'm thankful that Grant got off the road safe.
That is scary.
He was actually merging from 76 on the 422 when they it was messy, and my husband went out and tried to put brake fluid in, and it was just a shock. It just poured out, and so we had to have towed.
So we have towed from King of Prussia all the way to the France. And, but
yep, taken care of. So actually, it was Wednesday night. I had that wrong
because
he actually took my car to school Thursday. Thankfully, we have another vehicle.
Right.
And I'm not leaving the house. So.
Well, we give thanks for God's provision.
It was scary, but thankfully, he was safe. And
John, your
answer
to prayer.
Yes.
Any other joys or concerns? Ruthie?
In addition to what happened to Lola, her niece is coming out from Michigan for the funeral, and give her traveling no seats because it's not supposed to be the best weather. She'll be traveling on Thursday. Also, my granddaughter, Kylie, has been diagnosed with scoliosis of the spine, and so they've got to figure out a treatment for her. Hopefully it's not too bad, and don't need surgery, but she might need a brace or something, so they have to figure that out. And Kristen's good friend from college, Christy, lost her mom to COVID, and she was only 55. On a good note, I did finish my H&R Block, and I did get to in the church because you guys had Wi-Fi, and I did not.
Well, we so give thanks for you finishing that process.
Yes, thank you.
Anyone else, joys or concerns? All right, then, let's go before the Lord in prayer. God, we give you thanks for good news. We did receive, in a world where the news seems to be getting worse by the day, we did receive some good news this week. We thank you for Rachel, my niece, and her engagement. We thank you for Gary and Pam and their entire family, that they were able to get together in Europe and enjoy Christmas together as a family, and that you brought them, or brought two sets of them, safely home. And we pray that you continue to be with Rachel and Lucas in Germany. We thank you, God, for their ability to gather and celebrate the holiday together. And we thank you for Ruthie finishing her ancient art block and the course material that she had to study for. And we thank you that because of our almost a year old Wi-Fi installation in this church, that she was able to do that. So thank you for your provision in all kinds of ways, Lord. And also we thank you that, that we heard the news that Gordy Lance is home. And we rejoice and we celebrate your provision in that. But we also know that this is also a concern, because the manner of his care and the means of his care now shift to home base, and that's going to put a lot on Sherry. And we pray for her that you would give her patience and equip her with all the skill and wisdom that she is going to need, and just bless her and Gordy with continued restoration of health and restoration of life as they once knew it. God, we pray for Ira as well, who begins bone marrow treatment in the coming days, and we pray that that would be successful and that it would relieve the suffering that he has experienced for years. We pray, God, that this would be a breakthrough. But whatever should transpire, God, we do pray that you would point him toward yourself and toward your son and be with him and his entire family and Gary and his family too as they begin to move into this process together. And God, we give you thanks for people who fix our cars, especially when something goes on them very suddenly, as it did on Grant the other day. We thank you for your watching over him, and we pray, God, that you would continue to watch over Grant and all people who are traveling at this heavy travel time in which weather is sometimes an issue. And we thank you for his safety and for your protection of him. Thank you, God, for all that you're doing in Grant's life. And God, we do lift to you Lola's family, and we include Ruthie in that prayer, because Ruthie has been like a family member to Lola for many years. And we pray that your blessing would be upon all of them, Ruthie included at this time, as they walk through a season of grief. And as we as a congregation walk through a season of grief at the loss of Lola, and we can celebrate that she knew you and rejoices in your presence even now. We pray that you would watch over her niece as she comes from Michigan, and pray that you would grant her safe passage so that she can celebrate her mother's life together with us here on Friday. We pray for Kylie, God, as she has received and her family has received this diagnosis of scoliosis. We pray for a clear path for treatment and a successful path for treatment to be revealed by you, Lord, as they face this prospect together. And we pray for Christy, who lost her mother to COVID in recent days. God, there are many, many stories like that, and we do pray for all who are suffering in that way at this time. We pray, God, that you would ease the burden for Christy and for others. And we pray, God, for deliverance from this pestilence. We continue to pray for that. Lord, hear our prayer. As with all our prayers, God, we lift them to you, knowing that you hear them, knowing that you answer them in your love for us, knowing that you know the prayer requests that we did not speak aloud today. You know them because you know us and you love us. So we lift them all to you, spoken and unspoken concerns. In the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. We've reached the point in our service where we're taking the bread and the cup. Just a quick reminder, if you did not pick one up in the entryway, there are some in the windowsills and on the rail here, so you can come up and get one of those real quick. The way this works is there's a top clear cellophane layer with some words on it that covers the communion wafer. You can carefully take that off. And once that happens, you can look up at me so that I know you're ready. Body of Christ, take and eat and remember him. Now I invite you to be very careful with the purple foil layer, and then just gently remove that. Take your time so you don't spill it. Reveal the juice, and then once you're done, you can look up so that I know that we're ready. The body of Christ, the blood of Jesus, which saves from sin. Take all of you and remember our Lord. Our closing hymn today is We Would See Jesus. I invite you to stand together as we sing this closing hymn. It's number 256 in your hymnals. And if you're joining us online, I see there are a couple of you. The words to We Would See Jesus should be printed in your bulletin. We are going to start with verses 1 and 2. God, dismiss us with your blessing this day, so that we may go into this world that you love. And whatever may appear before us, help us to bring with us the presence of Jesus as we reveal him to be the light of life.